Very good morning. This morning we are going to meet a very special person, Dr. Sukhdev Thorat sir. Actually, in the Ambedkarite world and in the academia and in public in general, Dr. Sukhdev Thorat needs no introduction. But for some people, I would like to have a one or two liner introduction of Dr. Sukhdev Thorat. Dr. Sukhdev Thorat's life is very uniquely devoted to the emancipation of his people. And he has been completely devoting his time and energy to find ways to help in whatever he can to this huge project of emancipation that Baba Saheb Ambedkar launched. Now, this is his like social introduction, but as an academician, he has achieved the highest in the academic area. He is now the emeritus professor in JNU. He was the chairman of the highest body that looks after higher education in this country, the UGC. He was also on various committees of the government of India and the state governments and the international committees. Besides being contributing to the academic area, Thorat sir has a very special ability to look at the contemporary issues of social, political, economic importance of the not only the Dalit community, but the communities which are discriminated, which are at the receiving end of the system. So for his very committed service, Dr. Thorat sir was also awarded the one of the highest civilian awards of this country, the Padma Shri Award. Now, one of the remarkable contribution that doctor has made is in the field of the Dalit studies. In fact, he is the founder of an institute which is very unique in itself, the Indian Institute of Dalit Studies. And why this Indian Institute of Dalit Studies has been very important development in the Ambedkarite movement, because prior to the IIDS, there was not an institution which was bringing out the fact-based realities, the evidence-based realities of the society. For example, what is happening in terms of the economic development of a particular community, what kind of numbers, you know, indicate the facts of the social life, the economic life, what is the status of reservation, you know, how, whether the reservation has been effective, if it is, in what way, what manner, where, and so on and so forth. So this think tank, I would call IIDS a think tank, an institution that has been creating a lot of evidences in support of the social and economic facts, which are the very glaring and very pathetic realities of the Indian social life even today. So I think that is one of the greatest contribution that sir has made to the movement. So without taking much time, because you know I can go on and on. I met sir like 20 years back when he was in JNU. I was very young, but you know sir even entertained me that time when I went to see him in his office. So one of the remarkable quality of sir is that whether you are young, whether you are old, whether you are academician, whether you are non-academician, it doesn't matter to sir. You go to him and he will give his full attention to you. And that is what sir has done to me when I went to see him 20 years back in his office in JNU. So without taking much of your time, sir, Jai Bhim, sir, welcome to Ambedkar Karwan, sir. Jai Bhim and welcome, sir. So I request now, sir, to make his presentation on this very important topic today, the reservation for tomorrow. Because as we know that the reservation is in the crisis, the policy itself is being challenged in the courts, by the politicians, by the Hindu nationalists, and so on and so forth. So there is no other than Dr. Thorat sir who can give justice to this topic. So I request sir to kindly begin with his presentation, sir. Welcome and Jai Bhim, sir.
Well, good morning to all of you. Good morning to you, Mangesh. Thank you very much for inviting me on this online Ambedkar Karwa. My appreciation for you people being so active and trying to disseminate the knowledge and information on contemporary issues to the large community all over the world, including, of course, India. Now, as you had suggested that I should speak, is my voice clear now?
Very clear, sir. Very clear. Very clear.
As you suggested that I should speak on reservation policy and what are its emerging challenges and how to deal with those challenges. So I will discuss with you with the participant few aspects of this policy. Let me briefly mention what are the aspects that I am going to cover so that you have an idea what is going to come up for discussion. First, what I will do is mention about why reservation policy is used, or a similar policy to that of reservation policy, what are called affirmative action policy, and they are named by other in the world. So the need of reservation policy, why not just the policy for removing poverty, but why there is a policy for reservation. Then I'll come back to the second point, that how what was the reason as to why reservation policy was used for scheduled caste or the former untouchable. So that will I'll give a sort of a justification, how did it start it, and then discuss the policy itself. The provision in the constitution, the law, and the policy that we have today. I won't go into the impact of the policy because that will take a lot of time. But I will then switch over to what are the criticism of this policy in terms, and these are the challenges for the scheduled caste, because this policy has been constantly criticized on one or other ground. I can go into the reason for that also when I speak. So these are the, and then at the end, I will end up by saying what reforms are necessary in the present policy to be able to benefit it to the scheduled caste. And of course, this will be applicable to the tribe and other backward class, but I'll focus mainly on the untouchable, former untouchable, and the scheduled caste. But let us begin with why reservation policy is used in many countries in the world. The reason for this particular policy, which is, we called it reservation, USA and many other countries call it affirmative action. Netherlands, for example, use it in equal opportunity policy. Some use equal employment opportunity policy. Japan described it as a special measure. So the name are different, but the basic content is the same. Now, this policy is especially used for the discriminated group. That is, those group as a whole are discriminated. For them, this policy is developed. Now, what do we mean by discrimination? By discrimination, we essentially mean that it has been found that a certain group of people, group as a whole, are denied equal rights, which others enjoy. And that may include the right to property, right to employment, a certain category of employment, education, civic and political right. So a certain group may not have right to property. They may be debarred from employment or education, also the civic and political right. Now, one has to draw a distinction here that there is a difference between denial of right to an individual and denial of right to a group. An individual also get denied in access to certain rights. For example, you know, you are illiterate and you don't have resources, so you get excluded from the right to education. You don't have enough qualifications, so you get excluded from access to employment. You don't have resources, so you can't buy land or set up an entrepreneur, you get excluded. But this exclusion of an individual is different from that of an exclusion of a group. Here, you lack the capabilities. Nobody denies you equal right, but you lack capabilities. That is why you are excluded and you are landless, illiterate, and without income earning asset. In case of group discussion, is that this is based on a principle where it is argued that what people from one particular group are unequal, they cannot be treated on par with others, so they have a less right and the others have more right. So the people are denied right simply because of their identity, not because of their merit or qualities, but they are denied the right because of their identity. Now, it may be caste, racial, gender, color. The affirmative, the fact that it is based on ideology that no, everybody is equal. If everybody bonds equal, therefore everybody is entitled to equal rights, economic, political, educational, in employment, civic and political rights. So equality often recognizing every individual to be equal entitle them to have an equal right, equality before law or equal protection of law or equal opportunities. So that is the ground of the affirmative action policy. Let me summarize that in case of affirmative action policy is brought in because the general policy would not help much. It is brought in, which is focused on the group, which is for the development of the group, simply because they are denied equal right. And in order to give them equal right, this policy is used. Now let me come to the untouchable now, the untouchable in Indian society. You know, I need not repeat, everybody is familiar about the caste system, the Hindu social organization. Hindu constitute a majority population in this country, more than around 75 to 80%. They have their own social organization called caste system, which originated much, much early in the ancient period. But the caste system is based on division of people into groups called caste. The division of people into groups is also then accompanied by what is called assignment of rights. The rights, economic and social and political rights of each of the castes are decided well in advance by birth, and they are fixed, not to be changed at all. But the worst part of this assignment is that they are distributed assigned unequally. The high caste, which have more right, and the right goes down as you go in the caste hierarchy to the untouchable. So the feature of the caste system is that the Brahmins have all the right. The right gets reduced slightly to the Kshatriyas, then further get reduced for the Vaishya, further gets reduced for the Shudra, and the untouchable who are located at the bottom of the caste hierarchy, they don't have any right whatsoever. Economic, education, civil and political. I am talking of the classical test, Manusmriti and other this. The only job of the untouchable was to serve the high caste through an physical labor. So in short, the caste system is based on the principle of graded inequality. As you go down from top to the bottom, right gate reduced. But there is an additional feature that need to be understood, that in case of untouchable, not only that they are denied equal rights, that is, they don't have right to property, right to education, they don't have civil rights in Manusmriti, as laid down in Manusmriti. I don't have a time to read the actual verses that they did not have right to property. They could not accumulate the wealth. Their only job was to serve the high caste, and particularly the Brahmin. That is how is specified. So denial of equal rights. But denial of right also happened with respect to other castes to a certain extent. The Kshatriyas have a right to military, but they have right to education, but they cannot use education as a profession. Vaishya have a right to education, but they cannot use education as a profession of teaching. That is exclusively confined to Brahmin. Vaishya cannot take a job of military. So every caste has some denial of right and suffered from discrimination. But the untouchable suffer the most because they are denied all the right. But the unique and additional feature of the untouchable, which we must understand, is the institution of untouchability. That is, they are considered polluting and impure. And as a result of that, since they are polluting and impure, they are not to be touched, they are not to be seen, they are not to be approached. Therefore, they are physically and socially isolated, physically segregated and socially isolated. Now, physical segregation means that their residences would be away from the high caste. Now, that feature, which is a very common feature, is even available today. After the codification of the Hindu law by Manu in BC 200, even today, that every village has the residence of the scheduled caste, untouchable, is away from the high caste locality. In some cases, they have a separate settlement of their own. So you can see the residential segregation. That is because of they are impure. They are not supposed to have a physical contact with the high caste. And then there is the social isolation. There is no intercaste marriages. There is no social relation into dining or anything. They are deprived of the access to the public services and events in the village. Urban area, now the situation has changed. So the untouchable deprivation was very intense and very severe. That they are not only denied right to property, but they are also treated untouchable, and therefore they are segregated and isolated. The cumulative impact of all this denial of right was that untouchable did not have a property, income earning asset like the agricultural land or enterprises. They could not get into the quality employment like teaching, military, or all those good work which are part of the trade and commerce, which are done by the Vaishya, or in agriculture, they could not have a better job. The only job they were forced to do was the physical work. And that too, that physical work outside the house, because the inside house would involve physical touch. So the serving the high caste as a physical labor was the only job of the untouchable, and they turned out to be landless, illiterate, without capital asset, only served as a wage laborer. Now there is a recent evidence. Dr. Ambedkar had given a hint that untouchability is worse than slavery. He interpreted it in spiritual sense. But now there is a literature available that untouchable as a caste were treated as a slave and serf. There is a wonderful book by a scholar from CDS Devendram, who has written on the slavery of the pariahs and the untouchable. And then when I look into it, I am doing a project on untouchable and slavery. This was a common phenomenon all over India, that untouchable caste as a whole was treated as a slave. And all the features that you find in slavery, sale and purchase, underpayment, exploitation, division of families, separation of family, all those worst features of slavery are to be found in case of untouchable. Now, this is the status of untouchable. And I think it is a pretty old institution, the caste discrimination and untouchability. In fact, it is one of the oldest in the world. No other institution has survived that long. If I give you some figure very quickly, the first time the Varna system is mentioned is in Purushutta, in Rig Veda. And the historian would say that the period where the Purushutta was composed, perhaps introduced later on, is about 1500 to 1000 BC. But if we don't have solid record thereafter, but the written record is Manusmriti. Now, Manusmriti, there is no disagreement about the period of Manusmriti. Although all of them agree generally that the Manusmriti was composed BC 175 to 200. Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar also agreed and fixed that date. Jha, Sharma, those who have worked on untouchability and the origin of untouchability, they say that it was BC. About the origin of untouchability, there is some difference of opinion. Jha would say that untouchable as a caste emerged somewhere around 600 BC. It was also during the period of Buddha. There are evidence because Buddha talked about it. But Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar take it little further. According to him, it was AD 400 that the untouchability in its present form was appear. But whatever period we take, if you take 400 AD, it is old, as old as 1755 year. If you take earlier period, then it is 2000. So on the whole, this institution has survived for last 2050 years. There is no institution in the world which is that long survived. That this is a unique situation. Slavery was about 350 or 400 years old, the worst form of institution. But this institution of untouchability continue even during the British period. You know, when the British came, they passed what is called Anglo-Indian law. And that law was passed in 1772. And what is the provision? They said that we will respect, the law will respect everything related to caste. No interference in the caste relation, which means the right to property, education, and employment of untouchable will be as per the caste. Not only that, that in 1779, that is 7 years after the 1772 Act was passed, Anglo-Indian Act was passed, the British judges had a tough time to interpret the Hindu Shastras because they did not know Sanskrit. So what they did in 1979, they attach a Brahmin lawyer to the court and a Maulavi to the court because Hindu Muslim law has to be interpreted as per the Quran. So they were attached. Now you can imagine when an advice is taken from a Brahmin lawyer by a white judge, what will the Brahmin lawyer would say? He will interpret the caste system the way it is in Manusmriti. You know, when I was reading this literature on slavery, there is very interesting evidence. In Bangalore, in Calcutta, a woman who was a slave got a child from the owner of the her owner. Now he died. And then she went to the court because she wanted the property for her son. And but then relatives would deny. So she went to the court that, look, I am a slave of this gentleman and this is a child, his child, and I need a property share. Now, the British did not know anything what to do about it. They did not know the Hindu slavery. So a Brahmin lawyer was called and he was asked the opinion. You know, what did he say? He didn't say anything. He said that in Manusmriti, 7 slaves are recognized and in Narad Smriti, 15 slaves are recognized. Which means the Hindu slave, there is a slavery in Hinduism and that slavery continued even today. So the judge should interpret according to that. The judge should decide whether the property goes or not. You imagine the Manusmriti is written in 200 BC and Manu recognized 7 slaves. 2000 years later, the same law, Hindu law, is interpreted in the British court. That is the continuity of the untouchability. There were changes later on, of course. Many state provinces had brought some changes. Britishers themselves introduced education to scheduled caste in 1856. Property rights were given to untouchable in 1890, very late. Temple Entry Act was passed, you know that. Different provinces introduced certain acts under which the untouchable would get access to public amenities. You know Bole resolution in Bombay Presidency. Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar took the advantage of that Bole resolution, which says that untouchable will have access to all public amenities. And that is how the Mahad Satyagraha was fought. That is how the entry to the Nashik temple was fought. That was based on the Bole resolution. Shahu Maharaj introduced, you know, certain acts and in 1902, you developed a reservation policy. Okay, I have given you this history. It is necessary because youth should know what is the background. Now, what is the present policy of reservation? The present policy of reservation has its roots in Indian constitution. The Babasaheb Ambedkar began to fight for the political right of the untouchable since 1990. When he came back from England, he submitted a memorandum to South Bureau Committee in 1919, then in another memorandum in 1930, then there were memorandums submitted to the Roundtable Conference, that he made two, three points, which are very important. I'll give very briefly and then I go to the Constitution. He made a point that everybody should have an equal civil right. Civil right means right to expression, right to writing, right to public amenities, and everybody should have a political right, that is right to vote and right to make a law or unmake a law. So he first argument was equal civil right. And second argument was that since the rights are denied to the scheduled caste, there should be a legal protection, there should be law if there is a violation of the legal right. And third argument he made that since in a society they do not have access to employment, entry into military, in bureaucracy, right to property, right to education. A policy should be made whereby they should get this right. Well, he fought for that, and finally he got political representation in 1932 through Poona Pact. That the Scheduled Castes got political reservation, whereby they could contest from the reserve constituency and get entry into the state and central legislature. Now let me come to the state level, to the constitution. Constitutions, Baba Saheb being the drafting chairman of the drafting committee, he brought several provisions. I would not go into this in greater detail, but one of the important few features of the constitutions are very, very important. The constitution overturned the Manusmriti. The principle of equality, liberty, and fraternity became the foundation stone of our constitution. Accepting principle of equality and liberty. Liberty means freedom, and Manusmriti did not have freedom. There were restriction on occupation and other activities. So therefore, equality became the foundation. Equality and liberty and freedom became the foundation of the constitution. Equality before law. Because in Hindu society, there was no equality before law. The Hindu jurisprudence is such that for the same crime, they will give different punishment to different caste. So therefore, equality before law had to be brought in. Equal opportunity had to be brought in. So this was brought in. But equality was interpreted also. Because Baba Saheb was there, merely saying that everybody is equal is not enough. So he positively interpreted the equality in Indian context. That was that nobody will be discriminated on the basis of caste, race, religion, gender, or place of origin. So equality was interpreted taking discrimination into account. Now, these are the provision in the constitution. In directive principle, the directive principle direct the state government or the central government to enact the laws and develop the policy in a manner such that effect is given to the equality and equality before law. Therefore, these provisions were made. But in reality, there was no legal protection. Therefore, two laws were brought. First law was brought. That was Untouchability Offence Act of 1955. Baba Saheb was alive. Baba Saheb brought that Act of Untouchability Offence Act in 1954. And it was enacted in 1955. So that although the constitution gives you equal right, but in practice, if they are violated, then the untouchable should have right to go to the court and seek the justice. The Untouchability Offence Act does the same. Later on in 1989, another act was brought, that is the Anti-Untouchability Atrocity Act, because whenever the untouchable would try to seek and justice, the high caste would deny, not democratically, but violently. There will be atrocities. So therefore, Atrocity Act was brought in, which was amended and reframed in 2015. So this is the provision of the caste system as far as the legal safeguard is concerned. The safeguard in terms of ideas, in accepting principle of equality and legal safeguard. But the consequences of the denial of property right, right to education and employment was that the untouchable were landless, assetless, less educated, and they did not have civic right and political right. Civic and political right, we had brought the law. Now, what do we do about this? Therefore, an affirmative action policy, reservation policy was brought in, whereby they get an access to employment, access to education in proportion of their population. So the today's reservation policy has two components, you must understand. First is that since the discrimination persists in the practice, we must give them the fair share in public employment, in education, in public housing and enterprises. Therefore, the reservation policy was framed whereby it was decided that at least we will give 16% to them in government employment in proportion to their population. So population criteria was taken as a indicator of justice and fair representation in public employment, in education institution, and later on in the public housing also. Enterprises, some recent policy has come. But parallelly, this is the policy of giving a fair access. But parallelly, there were other policies. those policies are empowerment, economic empowerment. Because they were denied right to property, they were landless. They did not have enterprises. They had a less education. So therefore, additional program, general program were made so that they get land, they get access to entrepreneurship, that certain funds are given to them, scholarship are given to them so that they can have access to education. So this power policy for economic and education empowerment was parallelly taken along with the reservation policy to empower them. The spirit behind this policy of economic empowerment was, in my view, is that to compensate them for denial of right so long in the past in the history. So at the moment, what we have is we have a reservation policy which give fair share to the scheduled castes in public employment, in education institution, and in politics. But rest of them are minor measures. Private sector is excluded. It is only recently that private sector has taken some initiative and they are giving they have developed certain policies whereby they sponsor fellowship, help in professional education, promote self-employment. But it is all voluntary and self-regulated. There is no law, there is no monitoring, there is nothing. It is up to the private sector to have it. But this is what the policy that we have. To summarize, we have legal protection in terms of law, Untouchability Offence Act and Atrocity Act. And for economic and education empowerment and giving share to employment, we have a reservation according to the population in politics, in public employment, and in education institutions, and in public housing and all that. And some effort by the private sector. What are the challenges now? This policy has been there for quite some time, for last 50 to 60 years. And it has brought some changes. But nevertheless, the situation of the scheduled caste is still, they lag far too behind the high caste. The land ownership is very less, so they are still the largest group with the landlessness. The literacy rate is low, the access to higher education enrollment rate is low. Their share in the public employment is on par with their population share because there is a reservation. But I think their share in the private sector is much low, although there is no statistic. You take any indicator of subdevelopment. You take poverty, you take malnutrition, you take illiteracy. The untouchable lag behind the high caste. And they also lag behind the OBCs. So that although there has been an improvement, the improvement is not such that the gap has been reduced. And they finally turn out to be most poor and suffer from malnutrition and hunger. Now, there is a criticism of this policy. I think briefly I will mention those criticism and then go what policy should we have. You know, there is very unfortunate thing of India is that all policies for the poor, it may be NAREGA or it may be many other policies which are for the poor, are not opposed by the higher caste. But when it comes to reservation, which is also a policy which helped to reduce poverty of scheduled caste, there is opposition, constant opposition. Now, this is the very saddest part of it, although there is a very much need of this policy. What are the grounds on which this is proposed several times? This is support on the ground that, it is helping poor, rich among the scheduled caste, economically better off among the scheduled caste. Then it promotes inefficiency. It is not pro-poor. So these are the kind of arguments that are made. Now let me take these three arguments and answer and say that how these are based on myth and not on the facts. Let us take that this policy is not helping poor, this policy is helping the relatively economically better off class among the scheduled caste. Now, some of you who are watching my writing, I had published an article in EPW, Prejudice Against Reservation Policy, Why and How. Now, I have checked up that is the reservation policy only helping the the economically better off scheduled caste. We have defined economically better off, that's another point. But when I check up some of the statistics, I discovered that the reservation policy has in fact helped the large majority of the scheduled caste poor and a small majority of economically better off poor. What is the statistic? If you take, for example, central government job or state government job, they are into four categories, A, B, C, D. Now, C and D are obviously the clerk and the fourth class employees, security and attendance and all that. If you take the total employee into A, B, C and D category of the scheduled caste and work out the percentage of C and D, what you discover is almost 70% of the employees under reservation in Maharashtra or at all India level are C and D employees. Now, who are the C and D employees? These are the class 4 and class 3. Now, class 4 and class 3 employee who account 70, 65 to 70% of the job under reservation, who are they? They are matriculate, higher secondary dropouts, at the most college failure, and they join into the class 4 and class 3. So they benefited the most. And to say that the reservation is not pro-poor is something which is not very correct. Now, I have taken another alternative, that you take these all scheduled caste employees in the government services, central and the state, but all India I examine, and see their qualification. So you arrange them according to the qualification. So I have taken primary, middle, secondary, higher secondary, graduate and postgraduate. And then take out the percentage of this in the total employee. What you discover? That again 65 to 70% of them are with education less than higher secondary. 12th, matriculate, middle. Because they are in the class 4 and class 3 services. Very few of them are graduate and postgraduate. So it has certainly benefited the poor. I have taken another additional criteria. That is, you know, of the total, all India level, of the total scheduled caste in the reservation, government services, 37% are from rural area. Their origin is from rural area. Rest of them come from urban area. Now, in rural area, we get the land ownership statistic from other source. So, if you look at the land ownership background of this 37% of scheduled caste from rural area who got into the government job under reservation, what is their land background? What we discover is almost 80% of them own land less than 1.5 acre. And they got education and they enter into the government services. So, 1.5 acre of land, person with that background enter means reservation is hugely benefiting the poor. That is because why are they able to take education? They go into public education system at primary, middle, higher secondary. They get scholarship. They go to colleges where they get Government of India scholarship. So these are all poor. Even if you take, interesting point is, even if you take graduate and above among the scheduled caste who are under reserve category job, if you look at their land background is that they do not own more than 5 acre of land. So they benefited simply because of the scholarship and other things. So I think the argument that the reservation has not benefited poor and benefited more economically better background is a completely a bogus argument. It is based on myth and misunderstanding just to oppose the reservation on that. What is the intention behind that? The intention behind that is that eventually, what is the second argument then? If you argue that it doesn't help poor, it is based economically better off, then the argument is made that use economic criteria and exclude those who are economically better off. That is the motive, that bring economic criteria. You know what is happening in Maharashtra. I need not say with respect to scholarship. Income criteria is bought in. But many leaders, prominent leaders of particular political party, I don't want to name, they are arguing for economic criteria. Now, is economic criteria a suitable indicator for using reservation policy? In my opinion, this is also not based on theoretical understanding properly. Because they don't read, because this opposition is based on prejudices and myth, not on the facts. Now, economic criteria. Now, what is the ground for reservation? ground for reservation is not that you are poor, because then there are several other, there are poor from OBC, poor from high caste. There the anti-poverty policy is used. The reservation policy used only for those groups who are discriminated on the basis of caste and identity, and not on the basis of your economic standing. Because economically better off or economically worse off schedule, because both are discriminated. In village, when there is a residential segregation, a scheduled caste with 5 to 10 acre of land is not treated differently. He is also discriminated, and landless labor is also discriminated. He is not allowed to construct the house in the high caste locality. So the discrimination is neutral to your economic standing. You are discriminated because of caste. And therefore, even economically better off person also will require legal protection as well as reservation policy. Because if he is discriminated in employment and market and other places, economically better off, he also need protection against the discrimination. And also he need a share. He will not get a fair share in the employment or in education. Therefore, since the basis of discrimination is caste and not the economic standing, the basis of reservation has to be discrimination and not economics. Now, it is a different matter that those who are economically better off, they may not avail economic advantage. You know, if scheduled caste is give charge a lower fees, the economically better off would say that, no, I will pay the full fee or I won't take the subsidies. That is understandable. But that argument cannot be extended and said that they should also be denied reservation. So you can see that the argument that there should be an economic criteria and economic base is not based on a sound theoretical understanding. That is my answer to this question. Now, efficiency. They say that, you know, same scheduled caste employees are recruited with certain relaxation of 5% or 10%, or scheduled caste students are recruited in the education institution with some relaxation. It bring an efficiency. How come it bring an efficiency? If there are students who have given 5% relaxation from 60 to 60, 55. So there are students, some of the scheduled caste students are with 55%. But there are students from other caste also which fall in that range many times. But there are no studies again. The only study, very comprehensive study, is done by Ashwini Deshpande from Delhi School of Economics and her co-author Thomas Wiskopf. They have taken railways. Railway is the largest employer of a public jobs, and there is a concentration of huge concentration of scheduled caste because of reservation. They did a study, used a very sophisticated techniques of measuring efficiency. I don't want to go into that, but what is their finding? Their finding, two points are very important. They found that there is no difference in the efficiency between the scheduled caste and the high caste employees. They are equally efficient. On the contrary, Ashwini Deshpande and Wiskopf found that the officers from A to B category from scheduled caste tend to be more efficient than the others. This is the finding. Now, reflecting on the reason why as to why scheduled caste officers are slightly better off than the high caste, the reasons he found, she has not examined, but she is conjecturing, is that because they are condemned that you are coming with a lower qualification and under reservation, the scheduled caste officer is constantly conscious about it and they work hard. They have taken several indicators, whether you come on time or other indicators, clearing file, doing work on time. They found that they are better than others. Now, these are the statistical evidence. Yet the academician from the higher caste would cry, shout at the pitch of their voice that the reservation resulted to inefficiency. So, I have given you because these are issues which are discussed, therefore I thought I should give some time. So the argument against reservation policy, that it is biased against poor, that is inefficient, and therefore economic criteria should be brought in, is an argument which are not based on facts. These are arguments based on myth. As a matter of fact, these are based on prejudice. Now the reason for this is, why do they develop prejudices? The reason for prejudices is the following. There are theories of economic discrimination. You know, Baker was the first who developed the theory of discrimination with respect to race and gender in 1956. Then Yarrow, and Becker was a Nobel laureate. Yarrow was a Nobel laureate. Akerlof was a Nobel laureate. All these Nobel laureates developed a theory of economic discrimination. All of them put together, they have a common argument. That argument is that the discrimination gives the privileges to the person, caste or a group who discriminate. It gives privileges to the white, it gives privileges to the high caste, it gives privileges to the male or female. And the privileges are in terms of having a rights, economic right, education rights, social rights. Now, this dominant group, since they enjoy privileges and right over the subordinate group of scheduled caste or woman or black, reservation policy takes away part of those privileges. So the scheduled caste will now compete in a job with the high caste. Scheduled caste student will enter into education institution in high caste education institution. They will get into farming. They will get into entrepreneurship. They get into parliament through reservation. So the idea is that the privileges and the special rights that we enjoy, those are being snatched away now by this lower caste and black and woman. And our space of privileges is being reduced. That is the major intention behind opposition to the reservation policy. It is not because it is against poor. It is not because it is inefficient, but simply because heart of heart, the feeling is that our traditional rights are being reduced. Now, this is the basic message that we get from economic theories. Now, let me switch over to the last question. What should be the strategy now? What are the problems of the reservation policy and what should be the strategy? The problem of reservation policy is the following in India. Number one, that it is confined to a very tiny sector of public employment. The employment in government constitute a very small proportion of the total employment. Almost 80%, it must have been reduced, 80% is in the private sector. And it is in the private sector discrimination takes place, not in the public sector. Also in public sector, but not in a predominant way. It is the private sector. So the private sector is excluded from the reservation in employment. Private education sector is excluded. Say private university, private self-financing colleges, they are also excluded from reservation. So that is one of the major limitations of the reservation policy. But there are other limitations. Now reform, therefore we need a reform. Now this reform we require on two fronts. And I'll end with that. One of the problems of the scheduled caste particularly is that they are without land, they are without capital, entrepreneurship, they are less literate, and they are not into a better quality job because this was denied to them. Land was not allowed to own, entrepreneurship they were not allowed to own. The job like teaching, military, and those in trade and commerce where they were debarred. Education they were debarred, and the only job was wage worker, which bulk of them are there today. Now, If you are denied those rights, what's the solution? The solution is that the consequences of the past exclusion and denial need to be addressed. In fact, there are twofold problem. One is the consequences of the past exclusion, which result in the landlessness, illiteracy, less employment. But the discrimination also continues in the present, although there is a law. So you have also required safeguard against present discrimination in the form of law, as well as giving them fair share in employment. So the problem is double fold. That is, how do you take care of past exclusion? And how do you take care of the present exclusion? Now, as far as the past exclusion is concerned, all over the world, one particular policy is used, and that is called compensation or reparation. That if we have denied right to certain group, how do we compensate them? That is the framework of United States also. That if you hurt somebody, if you injure somebody, you have to pay a compensation. The untouchable were hurt by denying property right, by denying education, by denying entrepreneurship, by denying quality employment. And the consequences of which are to be seen. So how do you compensate them for the loss of land? Untouchable were physical labor, they were slaves, they were exploited, and the underpayment was met to them. They were given very low wages. Now, how do you compensate? So the compensation policy has to be used in order to give them land, share in entrepreneurship, share in education, fund for educational development, and share in actual employment, quality employment. Now, this compensation has been used as a matter of fact. You know that the Jews were subject to all kind of atrocities and atrocities during the Second World War. So Germany compensated to the victim. The compensation goes to victim. Wherever the victim were alive, they were given compensation. When the victim were not alive, some close relatives were given, identifiable relatives. And if nobody was available, they gave the funding to Israel, which became the state for Jews. During the Second World War, after the attack of Pearl Harbor by Japan, the Japanese in USA were put into concentration camp, some sort of a concentration camp. When the war was over, all the Japanese whose property was taken away and put into concentration camp, they were given $20,000 per person compensation. The woman which was sexually exploited during the Second World War by the Japanese soldier, those surviving women were given compensation. But we have never thought that for 2,500 years, the untouchable were denied right to property. They were denied right to entrepreneurship. They were denied right to education. And they were denied civic and political right. The result of which was landlessness, illiteracy, and over dependence on casual labor. We never thought that they should be compensated for land, for entrepreneurs, and for education. There were some effort. There are certain examples of that nature. For example, in Tamil Nadu, Panchami land was given for the untouchable. A British commissioner, officer, discovered that how come that these Periya caste in Tamil Nadu, nobody is landed? All are landless. Then he studied the Manusmriti and other thing, found that they were denied right to land. So a land distribution program was taken, that is called Panchami land. But it didn't succeed much. So we have not developed a policy, sound policy to give the land as a compensation. Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar in State and Minority argued for a nationalization of land because he argued that land reform would not help. There were priorities given to the scheduled caste in land distribution, but Dalit did not get the land. Scheduled caste did not get the land. So therefore they are landless now. Entrepreneurship, no policy. Now, some of the countries in the world, South Africa and Malaysia, use the reparation policy. Land distribution program in South Africa, land distribution program in Malaysia. But the good example of Malaysia is giving compensation for denial of entrepreneurship. And what they did? They purchased the shares and debenture for Malayas in the private and foreign companies. The Malayas, which are dominant, which are the majority group but the discriminated group, own only 7% of the share in the private companies and foreign companies. So the Malayan government in 1970 passed a act, rule, that all companies should have at least 30% of share owner from the Malayas. And today we have very high proportion of them. Now this is a compensation to the for the denial of ownership of enterprises. We were denied, untouchable were denied right to enterprises. You know, when Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar submitted his memorandum to the South Bureau Commission in 1990, you can read that South Bureau Commission, it is included, memorandum, you can read it. But after Dr. Ambedkar left the place, the member discussed what he said. And there one member said that Dr. Ambedkar has quoted that a Mahar woman in Bombay was arrested because she was selling watermelon. By rule, the untouchable were not allowed to sell fruits and vegetables. It is mentioned there. So there were restrictions on trade. Even today, there are restrictions. If untouchables start a grocery shop, no high caste will buy from them. If untouchables start a restaurant in the villages, very few of them will go. So Malaysia has used, South Africa has used the policy of compensation both with respect to land and entrepreneurship, which we have not done. We have to think about it, that how do we pay the scheduled caste, the land and entrepreneurship, and also fund for educational development so that they are paid. Now, this is the compensation policy which we have not employed, which we have. Now, let us come to the reservation policy, the current reservation policy. Now, the current reservation policy has some element of empowerment. But the basic objective of the current reservation policy is to provide a protection against discrimination so that they have a fair share. And that fair share is measured through population. That at least 16% of them should be in the government job, in the colleges and the university. So present reservation policy is not a compensatory policy. It doesn't give you land. It doesn't give you entrepreneurship. It doesn't give you job. It gives you only a share as a safeguard against discrimination in proportion to their population. So this policy, there is a need for extending it to the private sector. Because the discrimination in employment and entrepreneurship is very much there in the private sector. I have did a study how farmer face discrimination in sale and purchase of input. Ashim Prakash has done a study of the 19 Dalit entrepreneur, how they face discrimination in sale and purchase of their output, getting credit, getting places. So the reservation policy, the reform, what we have to do first is that we have to also extend it to the private sector. Both private entrepreneurship as well as private education. Now, there is a privatization of the education. Now, if you take the private colleges, about one-fifth of the student goes to the private colleges where there is no reservation, both in faculty as well as in student. So, the present reservation is only confined to a very tiny public sector. Now, you are aware how the privatization move has been expanding since early 90s. In the economy was liberalized and privatization was one of the part of liberalization. This government today, under the name of COVID, it is allocating money, but at the same time, taking the advantage of the situation, privatizing public enterprise. It's an open news, I mean, openly. Today, you read article in Indian Express. Labor laws has been modified, liberalized. Now, if privatization is going on a large scale and public sector constitutes a small proportion, the 16% of that post, how much it will elevate the Dalit? So therefore, I think the policy has to be extended to the private sector, see to it that they get fair share in entrepreneurship, in employment, in private educational institutions. These are necessary things. So I would suggest and end by saying that given that the untouchable continue to lag behind the high caste, dual policy should be applied, and that is the compensation to them for denial of right to property and education, and the present policy has to be extended to the private sector. Of course, it should be discussed with them. They are positive. They are only worried about private sector, only worried about that if it is made legal, they will be subject to serious constraint. So they are in favor of voluntary policy. So there should be a discussion with the private sector and this policy can be worked out. The compensation policy also can be worked out. I'll end by saying that compensation policy involves two, three things. One is that whom to compensate. So generally now the untouchable were affected and the victim of caste system, they need to be compensated. But you know, in compensatory policy, what we normally do is that we compensate the victim. Now in USA, they have found it out, sometime they find out the survivor of slavery and they are compensated. In fact, after the slavery, a compensation policy was developed. And that was 40 acres of land and one mule, so that everybody has a land, every black has a land. So in compensation policy, victim are identified and they are given compensation directly individually. Now in case of untouchable, we cannot identify the affected party and victim. Every untouchable is the affected party. Those who are without land, those who are without entrepreneurship. So our policy should be that for untouchable, we should focus on a group policy. How to increase the ownership of land, how to increase the entrepreneurship, how to increase the literacy level and higher education. So a program of compensation on all the three fronts. Now another issue is who should pay. Now in the law of compensation, the persons and the group which have benefited at the cost of denial of right to the untouchable, they should pay. That is the logical principles. Now here in case of scheduled caste, all the caste have benefited by denying right to scheduled caste, by denying right to education, Brahmins have benefited in employment. You know, since the Brahmin community has a right to education, they were the first one to get into bureaucracy even during Mughal period. And when the British brought the bureaucracy, it is the Brahmin which entered into the bureaucracy because they were educated, untouchable could not. Which means that the Brahmin and the higher caste benefited at the cost of the hurting the untouchables. So all the caste have a responsibility to help the untouchable, but I think I won't bring the caste into account, who pays and who not paid. All these policies of denial of property right and education and other things were implemented by the state. The state should be held responsible, and it is the state which should collect the fund and then see that how land can be distributed, entrepreneurship can be improved, education can be improved, fund can be allocated. I think we have to revise, we have to review Dalit policies, which we are only going business as usual, and the poverty of the Dalit is still very high. You have seen during COVID what has happened. What is the tragedy of the migrant worker? What is the tragedy of the informal worker? It is the informal worker which have suffered most. And I have seen the figure that the bulk of the scheduled castes are in informal sector. Casual laborer in the cities, street vendors, those who work without contract, those who work less than 1 year contract. They don't have a job security, they don't have social security, they don't have contributory fund or health security. All are on the road. You can see that. So unless they are economically, educationally strengthened, I think the situation will continue. I think these are some of the thoughts that, friends, I wanted to share with you. Thank you very much, Mangesh.
Sir, thank you. Thank you so much.
Your sound is very, very low. I can't listen to you.
Sir, can you hear me now?
You can type the question if possible.
Sir, can you hear me now?
No. No, from the beginning, your voice is a problem.
Okay, sir. I will type the question in the chat.
I must say you that what all that good thing you told about me to the people, I didn't listen.
That's good for me. That's good for
but
me.
Anyway,
sir, I will type the questions if you
yeah,
can.
Yeah, that will be better.
Go in the chat, but I think, sir. Now. I will just type a question here, sir. You touched upon, sir, all the aspects of reservation policy. You talked about all the aspects of reservation policy. Okay, like, you know, the areas in which the reservation policy has to be now integrated. Sir, what do you think about this political reservation and its connection with, you know, democracy and what is now called the proportional representation?
Okay, I understand. Now, political reservation, you know, the issue in political reservation is the following. You require a political reservation for the discriminated communities. Otherwise, they won't get into a parliament or state assemblies. We have an example of Muslim had a separate electorate. And they had a good representation in the parliament before 1950. The moment the separate electorate for Muslim was withdrawn, today we see that they account only 4%, 5% as against their population share of 14%. because the electoral process is discriminatory. Same is the story with women, that they constitute 50% of India's population. They are about 13-14%. Gender discrimination. So you require reservation for proportional representation to the discriminated community. And that is what we got it, Babasaheb argued it. But there are issues about this. You have mentioned, but I'll elaborate that. First is, does this political reservation and representation is nominal or real? There is a criticism, there is an argument that the representative of the scheduled caste do not really effectively represent them in the parliament or in the state assembly. Right. I think I have nothing against them. The crux of the matter is the following. If the scheduled caste MPs and MLAs are not able to be more effective simply because of the electoral method, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar had asked for a separate electorate, the way it was given to other minorities. Now, separate electorate means what? That in a reserve constituency, there are two candidates. One is the scheduled caste, other is the high caste. It's a dual member constituency.
Yeah.
The scheduled caste candidate is elected by the scheduled caste only. Besides, the scheduled caste have one more vote, which they cast for the higher caste.
Yes.
Now, in a separate electorate, dual member constituency, the schedule, since scheduled caste send their own candidate, he is accountable to their own people.
Yeah.
If he doesn't do anything, he will not be elected.
True.
So in a separate constituencies, the scheduled caste representative tend to be more genuine, more effective. But it was opposed and it was replaced by reservation, present reservation. What is present reservation? Present reservation is that the constituency it reserves, the candidate is scheduled caste and he is elected by both scheduled caste and high caste.
Right.
Now, since in majority of the reserve constituency, the majority population is the high caste, they decide which scheduled caste should be elected and sent in the assembly and parliament. So the election of the scheduled caste candidate depends on the majority high caste. Therefore, he listened to their wishes also. He knows that if he take the issues of Dalit too much, he may not get the ticket and he may not be elected. That is the crux of the problem. Now, at the time of constitution making, Babasaheb worked hard, not for the separate electorate. He tried for a separate electorate, but he suggested an alternative method, that is qualified joint electorate. There is a book by Rajshekhar Unruh on political reservation, very good book. He brings out this all debate. The qualified joint electorate means that the candidate that contests from the reserve constituency, see there are four scheduled caste candidates, ultimately the candidate whose vote should be counted if he gets 20 to 25% of scheduled caste vote. If he gets 20 to 25% of scheduled caste vote, then you take the general vote and do a total counting and whosoever get elected will be elected. Now here again, Babasaheb's argument was that again, he will be somewhat dependent on scheduled caste for election, for 25% of the vote. So the major problem today, it is not that the Dalit MPs or MLAs are insincere. No, they work very hard. They try to the extent possible, but the electoral method make them effective. There is a book by Mark Gallanton also that they won't be that vocal in the parliament and assemblies, but there are committees attached to the ministries and they do a lot of work, influence the policy. Special component plan was brought by many of them and other policies are there. So I think the political representation is very necessary. It also helping. I know that on critical issue, all of them, they come together, irrespective of political party. So they don't allow major decisions to be taken back, but also help through the committees to frame policies. But I think they can be more independent and free if we have an electoral method whereby their election is mainly dependent on the federal. Okay.
Sir, can you hear me now, sir? Sir,
I
your life
you.
Has been
coming
dedicated.
Closer to the screen. Okay, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, your life has been dedicated to calculate the discrimination, the caste discrimination. You have been calculating the caste discrimination through various methods, and you produce this very landmark study, which is known as Blocked by Caste, working with Catherine Newman. So can you please, you know, the kind of methods that you have been using, the kind of scholarship that you have been producing, sir, and there are a lot of people who are listening today who are young scholars. So what will be your advice to the young scholars as to how do they go into this field? What kind of, you know, attitudes they should have, and what kind of ways they should calculate and collect the evidences of the caste discrimination, sir?
Okay. Okay, I don't see you. I see Lord Buddha.
Sir, because sir, I had to bring my mouth close to the speaker, no, sir.
Okay.
So I thought it will look odd for the.
Okay. Well, I think we must understand one point that I have brought another book also, Untouchability in Rural India.
Yes,
it's a four-author study: Ghanshyam Shah, Arsmandar, and Deshpande.
Yes, sir.
Now. The block by caste is a unique study because the reason is that all our studies on discrimination as influenced by the Untouchable Offence Act, an atrocity act.
Right.
Now, generally, the Untouchability Offence Act and Atrocity Act, bulk of the provisions are related to social, cultural, religious, and other aspect of discrimination.
Sir,
there is a safeguard and binding punishment against economic discrimination also, but not so much.
Right.
So most of the studies are brings out that how untouchables are denied access to the public places like well, public road, temples, and many other things, and the misbehavior also in the school and other places. But the discrimination, economic discrimination in the marketplace, discrimination faced by the persons in employment in private sector, discrimination faced by the Dalit entrepreneurs in doing business,
right.
discrimination faced by the farmers in undertaking farming activities, these are very important, because your income depend on that. Whether you can own asset or not depend on them. Whether you get employment in private sector on this depend on the labor market discrimination. Now, this is the area which was completely neglected in India, at least. Now, when I was in USA, I mean in economics, I was trying to search for the literature on economic discrimination. So when I was there in USA for 2 years, I got in touch with the African American economist and gone through the entire literature, and then I have seen that how powerfully they have written on economic discrimination, market discrimination.
Right.
And therefore, when the Indian Institute of Dalit Studies were established, the first study I took was three villages, not many. I didn't get enough money, but the ILO gave me a funding to undertake a research on discrimination in employment and farming and enterprises. In fact, I submitted for 17 states, but the International Labour Organization at Geneva, they say, what is this Thora talking about? This discrimination in business and all that, and untouchability also.
Sir.
They say, okay, we agree, but do the survey for three villages, and I did that. There is an article in Blocked by Caste on discrimination in rural India. Now, the discrimination came out. Some of my hypotheses were correct. That I went to Haryana personally. I wanted to see with my eyes and talk to the Charmakars and the Valmikis. And Valmiki told me, sir, we start a small vegetable shop, no high caste will come. We have a cow, we want to sell our milk to the cooperative. The cooperative would not buy because the middle caste from Haryana, they threatened that if you mix the milk produced by the Valmikis into the general pool of the milk, we won't buy it. So you can see the level of discrimination. I was immediately aghast by this.
Right.
And of course, employment, discrimination in employment, no Valmiki woman or Charmakar woman is allowed to be a domestic servant or process vegetable or fruits. They can only work in the physical labor in the field. So there is discrimination in employment. Wages that they get is low. So based on that, I tried to publish and make a point. But Catherine Newman and her husband, they had sponsored a big study and they wanted some organization to undertake this in India. And they did a survey and they found that the Dalit Institute is possibly one of the potential institute where they can study. So we have an agreement and we did that study for 3 years and brought out that book. And I invited other scholars also. They also wrote on this. So block by caste is basically discover the discrimination in the economic sphere, which is one of the most neglected area and affect the Dalit much more. That is why it became very famous. You know, within 6 months, the first copy was out. They bought a second copy, and the next year they bought a paperback. Because your poverty really depend upon whether you have access to land. In the villages, we discover high caste would not sell the land to the scheduled caste. They will prefer the person of their own caste. Even if you give a land, they will give a land when you be very far away from the village, not which is adjoining with the high caste, not on the canal. So land access is very, very difficult. Similarly, same story is entrepreneurs. Now, let me summarize. I don't want to go into greater detail. Now, thereafter, we did a study of 4 states. On market discrimination, farmer, wage employment, and entrepreneurship. Right. And then we also studied the discrimination in government scheme, JSY, NREGA, and midday meal scheme, and others. That book is coming. That is the book which is established the discipline of economics of discrimination.
Very, very good.
That will come within a year's time. But the major finding that you get from it, that Dalit face discrimination in all the markets. Farmer face discrimination, as I told you. Entrepreneur face. We have taken the persons who start a noodle production, and a small restaurant, grocery shop.
Sir.
No high caste come and buy his noodles or no high caste come and buy food from his samosas or other thing. Grocery, they will at the most buy whenever they are in hard situation and they don't have that material with the high caste grocery owner, they'll only buy the packed food, pack items, not the loose one. Now the entrepreneur belonged to Dalit, they were really, when we talked to them in group discussion, they said, our income is so low because our demand confined to Dalits and their income is low, so our income is low, profit is less, and we don't survive much. Similarly, we have talked to the taxi, auto rickshaw and the taxi driver, they say, sir, the high caste generally will avoid us. They will prefer the taxi driver and the auto rickshaw of their own cars. So the economic discrimination is so immense. And that's one of the reasons why high poverty. So I'm bringing out another book, which will again establish the discipline of labor market discrimination with Madheshwar and another labor market discrimination. Discrimination in employment, discrimination in wages and occupation. These two books will let down the very, very foundation of economics of caste and economic discrimination. But in that book, labor market discrimination, we have added new things. That is, what is the impact of discrimination in employment on poverty? And we discovered discrimination, that is denial of employment and lower wages, reduce your income, and that reduced income land in your poverty. So we estimate the reduced income and we also examine the impact on poverty. So all the research scholars who are sitting and listening to me, I will suggest them that there is a lot of literature, African-American literature. You go to Google and search race and economic discrimination, discrimination in employment, discrimination in entrepreneurship, discrimination in housing. I have studied on discrimination in housing published in EPW. If you go to Google, you get the studies. And the labor market discrimination book that we are bringing out gives the method of measuring labor market discrimination. The first book will also give the method of measuring discrimination faced by farmer, entrepreneur, and laborer. Actual method and indicator. So this study will really help the young scholar to undertake a study of discrimination. But remember well that study of discrimination, we are concerned about economic discrimination because it has relation with income, it reduces income, it increases employment, unemployment, and affect poverty. It is precisely because of this reason we need it.
Sir, I will close the video for some time so that I can bring my mouth to the mic.
Yeah, I am holding the laptop to my ear.
Sir,
you
no
can
problem.
see that.
Sir, the question is, sir, your life has not been only dedicated to the research, but also you have done a lot of actions in the field. For example, you have always worked with the NGOs and the civil society organizations, and you have also tried to mobilize the communities. So my question to you, sir, in this scenario, when we see that there is very meager reservation and there is no new economic, no new reservation policy, no repair, no compensation, nothing. So what should be our political agenda? What should we do to mobilize the communities so that they can stand up for their rights? When the whole society is disorganized, when the things are moving apart, what kind of a political agenda that we should come up with, sir, and how we go forward with that?
Okay, thank you. I understand now because I can listen to
sorry,
you.
Sorry, sir.
Well, yes, you know, my what has happened is that I have been in the socially engaged in activism right from childhood. I remember that in my village, we did not have access to well and temple. And so R.S. Gavi, the former governor and president of the former Republican Party, came with an act of Untouchability Offense Act, talked to the Maratha peoples and Kunbi is there, very cooperative, and got the access to the well, similarly to the temple. Then entire Ambedkar movement was there in our villages, and I was a part of that as a child. I didn't understand much, but I was a part of that, and my brother was a part of that. When I went to Milind College, we were again a part of social activities in Milind College in Aurangabad. Same thing happened as a student in JNU. But when I started this institute, Indian Institute of Dalit Studies, this was really initiative of some of the NGO people, National Campaign on Dalit Human Rights, Martin McQuaan, who took a lead for this institute, Paul Diwakar, Vimal Thorat, Vinshen, all those leaders in the National Campaign on Dalit Human Rights.
Right, sir.
So they helped to set up this institute. There was nothing there. I took a 5-year leave. Everybody in JNU was laughing at me that you have offered to become a vice chancellor. You didn't become a vice chancellor and you are going to the institute where there is no land, nothing.
Right.
I went and started and did the study. But from the very beginning, then I thought that this institute, one of the purpose was to undertake research on areas and then share that knowledge with the activists.
Right.
So that they can bring their policies are evidence-based. Yeah. So I think the what IIDS does is that whatever research is taken on new areas, share with the NGO, share with policymaker, share with private parties, share with international funder. So that advocacy of research finding is undertaken. And then there is also action part of it, that these NGO get into action. So I associate it with them. As a matter of fact. So activism, academic activism has been a part of my entire activities. Now, your last question, what do we do when issues are there? Mangesh, I have written quite a lot on this in my those Marathi article in Lok Satta. Couple of articles. The book is coming and there is a separate section on this, what Dalit should do. I think the problem, I'm not talking of all India. All India also is the same story, but not exactly similar. But Maharashtra story is that we, for both for social activism, and social movement, and for political movement, we are heavily fragmented.
True.
I mean, we don't have a counting, but I think there must be 20-25 political parties.
Yeah.
All showing allegiance to Baba Saheb Ambedkar. Then there are several employees association, several Samta Sainik Dal. Now, so the one of the major problem of Dalit community here is that Dalit never organize on the basis of caste. That you must say. You can see that how other castes are openly take the caste name and found the organization. I do not want to name. But Dalit organizations are never named by caste. Mahar or Chamar or they are always based on goal and objectives. You know, sometimes Sainik Dal, Republican Party of India, all kind of name you can get, Socialist Republican Party. These are all because they are oriented towards the goal. But nevertheless, one of the major problem is the fragmentation. And so they cannot build up a united front socially and politically. Now, there is, because of that, there is a problem. This is not that they, this is not that Dalit cannot unite. They can unite around the issues, but they are not united as much on the issues of development and economic policy and social policy. You know that when Riddell issue came,
sure.
When Khair Lanjvi happened,
yeah.
When the Bharat Printing Press issue happened, lakhs of people went to Bombay. A very, very big show. So on certain issues, they come together. But on the issues of development and policy, they have not been able to come together because they are very scattered. I think one of the reasons, among other many other reasons, in my view, is the following, and I will convey to this, those who are listening this in a very clear term, is that one of the problems is that all of these people claim to be Ambedkarite. That we follow Ambedkar's ideology, philosophy, or thoughts, and does the activities on the basis of this.
Right.
But the major problem is that there is no clarity what Ambedkarism constitutes.
Right, sir. Right.
What is the Ambedkar's analysis of the problem, and what are the policies Dr. Ambedkar has proposed?
True.
So, to put in a brief, for all organizations, including political parties, all fraction of political party. All organized social organization are not based on the solution, ideological solution given by Dr. Ambedkar. And as a result, also not on the basis of the policy suggested by him. And that is the crux of the problem, beside unity and other thing. But the unity will come if there is a unity of thought and unity of policy. And there, We are completely not in conformity with what Baba Sahib has said. Now, let me tell you one thing. That Baba Sahib, in my view, is the most important book is State and Minority.
Right.
State and Minority was the memorandum submitted to the Constitution Assembly where he has given the solution. The title is like that.
Yeah,
State
yeah.
and Minority, Remedies.
Yeah.
To be incorporated in the constitution. Now that is that only not you give you policies and remedy, but that also has given the ideology of Baba Sahib.
Very nice, sir. Very nice.
Now that book has been bypassed. We give so much importance to annihilation of caste. Yes, annihilation of caste is important. It must be regarded and very powerful analysis. But the entire the crux of Ambedkar's thinking in terms of solution comes in State and Minorities. And what is the solution? That Babasaheb Ambedkar for the first time laid down his ideology. He has not laid down his ideology earlier. It is only in the State and Minorities. For example, if you take Independent Labour Party, he has not talked about ideology. He has talked about policies for labour. When it comes to the Scheduled Caste Federation in 1942, on ideology, he has a statement. He said, we don't believe in any ideology, one ideology. And he named Gandhism, Marxism, or capitalism. He said, whichever ideology is suitable to us, for Dalit, we will take it. So he did not take an ideological position even in 1942. There are policies, land distribution and other things. But within the private economy framework.
Right.
It is only in 1946, in State and Minority, he took a position that no, private economy based on private ownership of means of production will not be helpful for Dalit. It will create inequalities and also it will affect the liberty and freedom.
Wow.
That is the ideological position he took, clearly. Then he said, what is the alternative? Alternative, he said, is the socialist economy, social ownership of means of production by the state.
Right.
And there he named it as a socialism, state socialism. But with a parliamentary democracy.
So he
differ with the Marxist on the means. Because Marxist generally, the Marxist ideology is what? Social ownership of all the means of production. And political system, dictatorship of proletariat or one party system of worker.
He
differed. That, but he's on the same plane on socialistic economy as the Marxist.
True.
Marx talk about the socialistic economy, common means of ownership of production. He also, as a socialist, democratic socialist, which he brought it from Germany, state socialism concept is developed by Germany, in German thinkers. So state socialism means the ownership of land, nationalization of land owned by the state, distributed to the people equally.
Right.
Basic and key industry with the state, surplus earned from the basic and key industry used for the people. It doesn't go to the private. Education, health and insurance with the state. This was his state socialism. But rest of the economic activity he left to the private. Now this socialism has to be brought through the democratic way, through parliamentary democracy. There he differed with the communist. But as far as the socialistic economy idea is concerned, he's very close to the Marxist ideology. He draw from the German socialist. Now, he laid down his idea. Economy based on socialistic pattern. Democracy, political means, political structure is parliamentary democracy. Social system is based on equality. For the first time, he has given what kind of political, economic and social system Dalit should adopt or he believe in. And he has given in state and minority. And therefore, his remedies are twofold. He has given two remedies. Remedies against economic exploitation, remedies against social discrimination.
Excellent, right.
Remedies against economic exploitation, he has given socialism of a particular type. He, in fact, went step ahead and he talked of constitutional state socialism to make it a part of constitution. If you are making parliamentary democracy as a part of constitution, why not socialism?
That's
the question he raised to the Nehru and Rajgopalachari and Rajendra Prasad. They deny it. They say traditional British political jurisprudence and philosophy says that we only define political democracies, political structure and fundamental right, not economic structure. Economic structure, we leave to the legislature. They take the decision. It is not made a part of constitution. Constitution recognized private property. So Ambedkar's proposal was not accepted. Everybody was surprised that what a dramatic change he has suggested. So the point that I want to say you that the political, economic and social ideology of Babasaheb Ambedkar and the policies based on that are laid down in state and minority. Remedies against economic exploitations are mentioned in terms of socialism, democratic socialism. Remedies against caste discrimination is also given, special paragraph. There he says, law against discrimination, caste, untouchability, for fair representation, reservation policy, in employment, jobs and education, and third, separate settlement, because he believe that in a village economy, Dalit cannot get justice for two reasons. One is that Dalit in minority, population-wise, and that economically they're dependent on the high caste. So they have no strength to fight the majority, which is economically dominant. So he never visualized that Dalit in villages will have an equal civil right. Therefore, he said there should be a separate settlement and they should be given separate land. So he used the word, there should be a disconnect between the high caste and the low caste in the villages. And so he talked of separate settlement. He also emphasized on urbanization and industrialization because in urban areas, there is a less discrimination and atrocity. Now, this is the ideology of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. Now, we have not accepted this. Let me tell you a story now, since you have brought this discussion. Babasaheb established the Republican Party of India, brought out an open letter. But he did not have a time to mention the ideology. He only meant parliamentary democracy and how democracy can be successful, what are the conditions and all that. And then Mahaparinirvan, but he could not lay down the ideology. The Republican Party was set up in 1957-58 period. A committee, 5-member committee was set up to frame the manifesto of the Republican Party. D.C. Kamble, Rupote, Pawar and 2 more people. Aude Vugare. Now, their responsibility was to get to know what is final ideology of Babasaheb Ambedkar, which economic, social and political system he believed in.
Right.
What they did is, they did not do that. In the ideology section, if you read the Republican Party of India first manifesto, they have picked up that sentence from the Scheduled Caste Federation manifesto. That we do not believe in Gandhism, Marxism and capitalism. We will take any ideology which will benefit us.
So they bypassed states and minorities.
Now,
They bypassed states and minorities.
They bypassed the states and minorities. Yeah. But there is one thing. They were very clever people.
Mm-hmm.
They took all policies based on state and minorities. They talk of nationalization of land. They talk about industry. They talk about nationalization of bank, insurance. They took the policies. But on ideology, they borrowed it from Scheduled Caste Federation. They were aware about it. They had an inferiority complex. So they went a step ahead and say, we are in favor of mixed economy.
Oh.
Mixed economy is not ideology. So I think that it is a dishonesty of this member. I'm sorry, I'm using a strong word. Had they brought state socialism with parliamentary democracy and caste-based social system based on equality, the Republican Party would have got a direction. Now there is no ideology.
Right.
Those with BJP is also Ambedkarite. Those with Congress is also Ambedkarite. Those without any understanding is also Ambedkarite.
True.
So the one of the reason why disintegration occurred, fragmentation occurred, simply because people, they are honest. Those who go to Congress, BJP, they think that they can do something for the elite. They bring policies. But they do not have any idea of the ideology, which economic and political and social system is in the interest.
True.
So that is one of the reasons. So therefore,
sir,
my suggestion would be that we have to bring an understanding on what constitute Dr. Ambedkar, what economy he stands for, what society he stands for, what political system he stands for, you know. For example, method of political representation. We have to discuss this, brought it together, and then interpret his ideology in the present context, and then put up before people that if you are calling Ambedkarite as a solution to the problem, this is what it is. And then come together. Why are you separate? If you call yourself Ambedkarite, then come around this ideology. So I think this. We need to use Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar's word, we need to re-educate ourselves about the ideology of Dr. Ambedkar and then agitate and then organize. So it's a stupendous task of rebuilding the Dalit and uniting the Dalit, but ideological recognition and common ideology, which we can modify, but ideology, Dr. Ambedkar's ideology has to be put in front.
Sir, that was a very, very good interaction. Sorry, my voice is very low. That was a very, very good interaction, sir.
Okay.
And, you know, there is a tremendous response from the listeners. They have been, you know, commenting on it. And I think we have come to the end of our discussion today. But we would like to invite you again and again to discuss more about, you know, what you just talked. Because for the first time, you know, some of the viewers are listening to this kind of a thinking about the Ambedkar ideology. And I think that's a very, very clarifying point, sir. And that is the way we can mobilize our people based on this ideology and the policies, so on and so forth. And I think that was a wonderful, wonderful presentation from you, sir. And thank you so much for joining in, sir.
Well, thank you very much.
Sir, you can have the concluding words, a few concluding words, sir.
Yeah. Thank you.
Sir, you can go for the concluding words. A few concluding words, sir. Last concluding words before we go.
No, my comforting word is that since the most of the listeners are the youth, educated youth, youth which are concerned and youth which are in activism, I think what they should do is to what I said, that we have to develop a common framework of ideology and policies and program. Not necessarily all that is said by Babasaheb Ambedkar we can apply in practice, but at least we must know what are the general ideas, ideology, and then we can modify. For example, nationalization of land will not take place. But definitely the inequality in land ownership is the issue which he has brought in.
True.
Now, we can see that in the present context, what are the policies whereby we can bring access to the ownership of land to the Dalit? So, unless we do not have a framework of Babasaheb, we cannot, in a contemporary context, we cannot interpret it. For example, he wanted basic and key industry into government. Now it is being privatized. Now then we will have to modify that basic message of a Babasaheb remains, but how do we get a due share in the private industry?
True.
Education is being privatized, which go against the views of Babasaheb Ambedkar. But we can interpret it in a manner such that how do Dalit get equal access to the private education?
Right,
so
right.
There is a lot of exercise which has to be done. My request to youth will be that please read Babasaheb, State and Minorities and His Remedies, have discussion and develop ideological framework and policy framework, and around that try to educate people to come together. This unity of Dalit based on individual is not going to work. This is based on enmity against each other. So it won't work. The unity should be based around ideology and policies and program. There you can challenge them that if you are talking of Ambedkarism, then this is what Ambedkarism is. Come around. But otherwise you can't. So this is your responsibility to take the responsibility on a large scale.
Right.
I am doing that. I have set up an association for social and economic equality. I do educating and write and read and all that. But when I see that everywhere I go, there politics comes in. You know, I have gone to certain districts and towns and taken these messages. Then next time they don't invite me. I say, why? Because they are briefed by their leaders not to invite, because he has a political ambition perhaps. So it's difficult. It is very difficult, but you have to take a lead. You are the future. Nobody else is the future. But you have to read it. You have to re-educate yourself, understand it, and then prepare the common approach.
That was our beloved Thoras sir, who has really, really gone into the depth of the issue, and also he has educated us a lot today about not only reservation policy, but all those very, very important issues that are pressing, and you know, we need to do something about it. Sir has given us a very clear-cut guideline as to what possibly we can do, what direction we can go, and how we can fight our battle for the reclamation of human personality. Thank you so much, sir, for being here, and we would like to invite you again for the discussion in the future, sir. So thank you so much, and Jai Bhim to you all, to all the listeners. Jai Bhim.
Okay, bye.
1 minute, sir.